last session of the day started on geospatial intelligence and finding a solution for Indonesia's haze problem. So if you could all please take your seats, we will get everybody else to come in. Geospatial intelligence is, I think, a very new field of study, and of course, Six Capital and Universitas Gadjah Mada have been working very hard on finding a solution to some of the intractable challenges facing Indonesia. Now, of course, we know that every year, during the hot summer months, we face the haze issue. How do we find a solution for this? I think the president has indicated that he is very serious in making sure that we minimize it and at least at the start, and then ultimately eliminate the haze issue. Of course, the haze is also not just in terms of pollution, but it has major ramifications for the economy, for the health of Indonesians, and of course for many of our Southeast Asian neighbors. So this is a very special session. I think we have a very exciting and very in-depth panel that we have put together for this special session. So it is my honor now to invite Dr. Danang from UGM, who is your moderator for the day. And Dr. Danang will then invite his panelists.
Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Now we are entering the last session of today. So I would like to introduce myself. I'm Danang Siratmoko. I'm lecturer from Faculty of Geography, Universitas Gadjah Mada. And we will have six presenters here. So I would like to invite first Mr. Paul Tang, CEO from Six Cap Group. Please have a seat. And second, I would like to invite Dr. Imadi Andi Arsana. He is from Geodetic and Geoinformatic Department, Faculty of Engineering, UGM. He is also specialized on maritime boundary. He will talk about the geosecurity related to the maritime issues. And of course, Dr. Trias Aditya, he is come from associate professor from Geoinformatic and Geodetic Engineering, the same faculty as Pak Andi. He would like to talk about the high resolution geospatial data on tackling the issue of the haze at the Pulau Padang. And the next, Papa Indra Utoyo, the CEO of Media Services, PT Telkom Indonesia. And the following speaker will be Dr. Budi Wardana, the Deputy for Partnership and Planning from Peatland Restoration Agency, from the governmental officer. And also Anita Hesti, representative from Faculty of Agriculture of UGM, who like to talk about the Digital Extension Society on Agriculture. Okay, so may I take a seat here? So ladies and gentlemen, in this session, we would like to talk about the geospatial technology on handling some issues in Indonesia. As explained by Pak Soeb, that Indonesia is one of the largest archipelago country in the world. We have more than 17,000 islands that we have. Some of them we are still naming, from the BIG, Badan Informasi Geospasial. And from Sumatra to Papua, we have the distance more than 5,000 kilometers, even larger than the distance from California to New York. And within 250 million people spread over more than 80,000 villages in Indonesia. So 10% of this population are farmers. So IPST will elaborate more and how to handle the farmers that represent 10% of the population of Indonesia. And we also have a second largest mega biodiversity in Indonesia. However, besides of the resources that we have, we also have some issues have to be tackled, some challenges that Indonesia are suffering every year. One of them are issue of the heat problem, of the peatland problem, peatland management problem, and also other disaster that we have to tackle. Boundary issues, yeah, Dr. Amimadi Andi Arsana would like to talk about. And also how to innovate, yeah, all the data, how to tackle and how to integrate all the geospatial data into one portal database using the GIS, Geoinformation Technology, and how to combine with the crowdsource power, yeah, with all the data that we collect within the big data analytic also. And Mr. Paul Tang also would like to talk about the how to use the QGaming, how to innovate, yeah, that all the data on the how to educate the people on regarding to tackle all of the issue. I would like to start with Dr. Imadi Andi Arsana. Would like to introduce a little bit on what is actually the geospatial technology. Please, Dr. Andi Arsana.
On. Thank you. Thank you, Pak Danang, for the introduction. I have to be here because I need to see my own slides. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a great honor for me to be here, being a surveyor, to be in front of the economists and also in the economic forum is a quite humbling experience, so I thank you very much for this. Geospatial intelligence, it can be a one-session lecture, but I would like to make it in 3 minutes. Anything on Earth, we talk about the space on Earth is geospatial. So this is the picture of the Earth, if you may say. So anything on surface of the Earth is what we call geospatial science and technology. So when we talk about the geospatial science, the first question that we'd like to answer is like, where on Earth are we? So we are talking about position here, position on Earth. And geospatial intelligence, in general, we could say that intelligence or activities that is utilizing geospatial data, which is the surface of the Earth, to obtain information and data and information. So basically, if we capture the surface of the Earth using any kind of technology, and then we try to extract information out of that, this is what we call the geospatial intelligence. Now, in particular, I would like to introduce to you how geospatial technology and science and data are utilized in managing boundary issues in Indonesia. I call my presentation as a geo-maritime security, geospatial aspects of international maritime boundaries. Before I begin, I would like to show you a recent case taken place in the South China Sea. I think this is one of the most infamous case recently. On 19 March 2016, there was an incident close to the Natuna Islands involving a vessel from China. So there was a Chinese vessel came to a water close to Natuna and did some fishing over there. Not only one, it is two, three, and even more, four. And Indonesia is certain that this area is part of Indonesian waters. That is why then Indonesian patrolling officer came and to capture them. Excuse me for using this image. I know that Ibu Susi is not here, so I can use this image. To capture those four vessels. But what happens in a few minutes after that is that a bigger vessel came to secure and to rescue those Chinese vessels. I will stop the story here. What happens actually in regards to maritime security and boundaries? Now, For those who are not in the law of the sea field, I would like to reintroduce to you what is the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. This is basically the international law that governs how a coastal state can claim ocean based on legal principles. This is what happens. So let's say this is the land and ocean. Based on the law of the sea, a coastal state can claim 12 nautical miles of territorial sea. Beyond that is 200 nautical miles of exclusive economic zone. Beyond that is continental shelf. So it means that a coastal state, or a state like Indonesia or Singapore, is entitled to claim a very large maritime area. A country like Indonesia, that consists of, like Pak Danang already mentioned, thousands of islands like this, it is entitled to designate what we call an archipelagic baseline. This is basically a blanket that covers the entire archipelago, and then can claim the 12 nautical miles out of that, 24, 200, and even beyond that. So simply speaking, a country like Indonesia is able to claim a very large maritime area based on the Law of the Sea Convention. If I illustrate in a very simple illustration, a small area or small country like this, if it is alone in the ocean without any neighbors, it will be able to claim a very large maritime area, very, very large. So if I have an example of 1 kilometer square land, it will be able to claim more than 1,000 times of its own size. It is very large, based on the Law of the Sea Convention. However, we understand that there is no country like this, there's no country that is locating alone in the ocean, because we know that the world look like, you know, there are many countries, hundreds of countries in the world. This is the illustration. Let's say there are countries like this, A, B, C, D, E, and F. Each country will be able to claim 12 nautical miles of territorial sea based on the Law of the Sea Convention. So if you see here, between state C and D, there will be no issue, no conflict, until each of them are claiming EEZ, or exclusive economic zone. And then we can see the overlapping entitlement between C and D, for example, where maritime boundaries is needed. So this is what we call maritime boundary delimitation. It is also, this C and D is what we call the opposite states. Between A and B, for example, it is called the adjacent state, which also requires maritime boundaries. Now, if we talk about the Law of the Sea Convention here, it refers to different articles, different provisions in the Law of the Sea Convention. Now, this is the continental shelf, if you still remember that. And now we imagine, or we can see that between state F, which is in the corner over there, F, and state B, for example, they are close to each other, but they do not need to settle any boundaries because they are far enough, according to the Law of the Sea Convention. But what happens if a country like F is claiming ocean not based on the Law of the Sea Convention, but based on what they want, like this? There will be overlapping claim, overlapping waters over there that is not recognized by B, but recognized by F only. We are going to talk about this on in the South China Sea. Now, if we apply those principles into Indonesia, this is what Indonesia would look like. So this is the boundaries between Indonesia and other countries. So if you see this, for example, to the west of Sumatra, Indonesia is able to claim 200 nautical miles without any overlapping entitlement with any other neighbors. So no boundaries is needed. If you see a small island over here, south of Java, there is a red line over there. It is boundaries. Why boundaries is needed there? Because the small island belongs to Australia. So it is very interesting to observe that a small island very close to Java and very far away from Australia, but it belongs to Australia. When I saw this to a student, my students usually they ask me, why don't we claim that one? I said, no, don't do that. It's so this is a principles that teaches us distance does not matter when it comes to sovereignty. So we don't really talk about distance when it comes to sovereignty. We talk about law. Do you know why? I think some of you would understand that the Christmas Island were not with the Dutch, but with the British. That is why it is now part of Australia instead of part of Indonesia. Some other thing that we need to understand is that the red line is actually the agreed line between Indonesia and other countries, other neighbors. But this line, that the Dutch line, the blue line, for example, it is with Palau. This is the land that Indonesia wants. But if you talk about, or you consult with Palau, Palau wants other line, which is this one. So it means that there will be overlapping claim between Indonesia and Palau. So it means that the map that we see every day in Indonesia does not represent the final map of Indonesian water, because the line has not yet agreed with Palau, for example.